Hello and welcome to Close Up. In this edition of the program, we are meeting with a son of the soil and I dare say an ambassador who has been flying the flag of the country for as long as I can remember. And in fact, every time you hear of the name Terry Gajraj, there's another name that comes to mind, the Guyanese Babu. Well, he is back home as he has been doing quite a bit. And so Terry has, of course, afforded us the opportunity to sit and have a little conversation with us. Welcome home, champ. How are you doing?
Very good. Thank you. Always a pleasure to be in Guyana. You know, despite the circumstances, I love it. My navel string joke here, so I'm there.
All right. So you're doing your thing. You've always, as I said at the top, always been coming back home.
Sure.
And Terry Gajraj has been a household name for many, many years. So we're not even going to go into who Terry Gajraj is.
Correct.
The entire country should know. But just for reference, you're a recording artist, doing your stuff,
yeah.
Flying the country's flag. You have been in the U.S. for quite a number of years.
Correct.
Your entire family is up there. Let's talk a bit about what's happening with your family.
You know, mom, dad, you know, we're all trying to be very careful. They're older now. So they make sure they got their vaccines. And due to the coronavirus, you know, I've been seeing a lot more of them. So that's the positive, you know, because usually I'm out every single week. Different country, different city performing. So these days it's primarily virtual performances and only little tiny private performances, which is just small gatherings and being socially distant.
Terry, and I'll use that, I'll use your first name for the rest of the conversation. And I know you commented with it, so I'll stick with that.
Yes.
Now, we both are from the countryside, and
yes.
So I know Berbice is your sweetheart. What's happening in the ancient county?
You know, I went up to Berbice on Monday and it was so nice to be back home, you know, see the people whom I love, and went down to the old house where my cousin is now living. We visited one of the handicapped girls who needed some help in Canefield Settlement. Kanji, yeah. That's your hometown.
That's right, you know? That's right.
Yeah, and we went up to Highbury, the site of the Indian monument.
Right.
You know, our ancestors came in 1838, so
right.
I just wanted to go and pay tribute
homage,
and
right.
offer a little, you know, prayer. And so I did that, and I can't wait to go back to Berbice, though I've seen it so many times. I've lived there so many years.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, home is home. Like I said in my song, you can take me out of Guyana, but you can't take Guyana out of me.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about your work. And you are a musician at heart. You've been singing for a number of years, always flying the Guyanese flag. I don't think we can ever take that from you.
No, you can't. You know, I love doing it, you know. I feel very strongly about my roots, my culture, my traditions, and of course, that's the beautiful land of Guyana that we all came from. And when I first started and went to America, people, Guyanese didn't want to admit they were Guyanese. Oh, they're somebody else. I don't know why they were ashamed to be Guyanese. People wouldn't fly a Guyana flag. And that is what prompted me and motivated me to always walk with my Guyana flag, you know, and wave it so they could see that, you know, singers, we are proud of whom we are.
Yeah.
We are proud of our identity. We are lost if we don't have an identity.
Now, we've just said it for those of our friends that are joining us on The Voice of Guyana. But for those in television land, you can probably wave that flag a little bit. You've got it on your tie. You walk everywhere with it.
Oh, yes.
So there is Terry with his flag.
Doesn't matter where it goes.
Yeah, you know, so you've always got that flying. Now, tell us what it means for you, especially in a foreign country, Terry, for as long as you've been in the U.S., having the flag with you. Is it a signature mark for you?
It is. And, you know, I take a picture, people do different things. Me, always one, like one people, one nation, one destiny. And it's all about one love. We are all one people. Doesn't matter what you say. And when you live in Guyana, and I think so many other Guyanese share the same experiences, you kind of take Guyana for granted, you know? But it's when you leave Guyana, then, like you say, you never miss the water till the well run dry. It's when you leave Guyana, then you start appreciating everything Guyana, you know, and not just the food and the people and the pretty girl and everything, you know? Yes. Yeah, and that is the reason why I wanted to, because here we always tend to have like that foreign mind. Everything outside is better, you know, that foreign mentality. So I wanted to let people see how beautiful Guyana is. And funny enough, it's easy because people want to know where you're from. Like, I have family, close family. They don't want to admit they're Guyanese. They would never say, I'm Guyanese. But their children are teaching them to be Guyanese. Because when they go to school and the Puerto Rican waving their flag and the African waving their flag, and you know, you have those days when you talk about your country, your background, your nationality, the Guyanese kids are lost. So now they are teaching their parents how to about their identity and being proud of your heritage.
Yeah, I think that's a terrific campaign right there. Your work as a musician, Terry, has of course taken a hit just by like everyone else, but you continue on the front line with COVID. COVID has affected just about everybody.
Yes,
and
sir.
Ordinarily, you would have been very, very busy, as you said from the top of the program, going state to state performing. These days, many of your performances are virtual. The vibe you generally get as a musician is off of your fans, your people, your fan base. Somewhat that's been stymied by COVID. How are you dealing with this challenge?
It's been hard, you know, and especially like myself. Since Guyana Babu came out, me never stopped performing. Every single week, every single month, every single year for over 25 years.
Wow.
And you know, every year I try to add a different city, a different province, a different state, a different country. And I have been doing that, except for last year because of the COVID. I had Thailand on the agenda and New Zealand. I was supposed to do an event, a Guyanese event in New Zealand, unfortunately, you know. And this year I had Belgium scheduled. But we won't be able to do it this year, but it'll be hopefully next year, we're hoping. Everyone take their vaccines or jabs, like you said, Mark.
Yeah, take the jabs.
You know, and wear your mask and, you know, just wash up your hand and things like that. Yeah. So, you know, things could get better. We can get to hug each other again.
You've got a few soundbites out there in the public domain about the importance of people taking the COVID-19 very seriously. I heard you, it's on the airwaves. Washing your hands and making sure that you sanitize.
Yes.
This is very, very important to you. Have you lost anybody as a result of COVID or close friends? Have you lost anybody?
You know, I haven't lost any close relatives or close friends. I've lost friends, but not from the COVID, from other things. But we have seen the numbers, you know, every day. But I do have friends who were affected by it. They got a COVID. Some of them took 3 days. One of my friends, he took 3 weeks. His parents got the COVID because they lived in the same house. They recovered much quickly than he did for some reason. He's like, you know, strong and everything. But it took him 3 weeks to recover. So I'm very fortunate that no one close died of the COVID. But, you know, you look on the television, we see the numbers are staggering. And, you know, it's a dose of reality for us to be extra careful.
Right. I know the story in Guyana is different, at least in, as it relates to the numbers in the U.S. where you're from.
Right.
The Guyanese situation, you're just back home for a week, but you've seen numbers rise and fall in Guyana, not as many as you've got in the U.S. Let's first talk about the Guyana story with COVID and what, you know, from your observation, what you've picked up so far.
You know, one of the things, and not just in Guyana, but over there, but I noticed it here as well. They say, wear your mask, wear your mask, wear your mask, wear your mask, wear your mask. But, I mean, remember, you could get it through your eyes, through your, anything that goes into your body, you could get it there. But one of the things I think that we neglect, and that's in America as well as here, is your hands. You know, your hands touch all surfaces. You hold this, money. So I think I personally think, you know, gloves or washing your hands or sanitizing is, I dare to say, more important, but I know the mask is the thing that you have to have there because, you know, you can breathe in the particles, but this here is a big culprit. So my message to Guyana would be, wash as much as you can. If you're gonna get soap, just wash with water. You know, walk with a little hand wipe and thing like that if you can, you know, or wipe it, man. Water works magic, you know. Just wash up as much as you can. And in addition to the mask, and you know, we should be better, a little more additional protection.
Terry, the world, COVID is a pandemic.
Yes.
And it's one different from any other we've ever seen.
Yes.
Societies are still shocked, still not recovering fully. Even in the US, you still have communities that are still going under mentally with the stress of COVID.
Correct.
How do you think, and we're going to go to the US where, you, yeah. where you're living in a bit, but how do you think the people of the country, from what you've seen, Guyana here, in this particular question, have dealt with it? Do you think they are on board, efforts by the Ministry of Health? Do you think they're, you know, pretty much on target with how we should address and deal with COVID to protect and provide for the people?
You know, what I love, firstly, is you guys, like on television, radio, you know, I've been on a few interviews, and I love the fact that everyone drives it home. Mm-hmm. So anybody who's listening, you know, can take it seriously. Right. And then even when you go out there, you know, some take it a little too lackadaisical.
Relax,
they're not too serious about it. But then there are folks who are really, yo, mask off. You take out your mask to take out a picture.
Yeah.
Like, why you think, you know. So I was telling, man, I don't need a mask to take out a picture, right? But, you know, it sends a nice message still. So I think those who are not taking it seriously, we need to take it a little bit more seriously. The mask, the gloves, and, you know, with every negative, there's always a little positive. Mm-hmm. I find that COVID is teaching us to be healthier human beings.
Okay.
You know, apart from the mask and the gloves, you know, eating right. Mm-hmm. You know, getting your vitamin C, your antioxidants. And the beautiful thing with Guyana, fruits are in abundance. Mm-hmm. And that's the best thing that you can use and you can eat and have in your stomach. The guava, for instance, it is so packed with vitamin C. And every guava tree you go, you can find a guava. And guava is ridiculously cheap, you know?
Yeah.
So those are, and one of the things that I like to do in the morning when I wake up, instead of eat roti or egg ball or something like that, you're like fasting all night. The stomach is empty. It's nice to put something really good. The best thing that you can put in your stomach, put it first thing because it'll be absorbed. Mm. Whether it's water, fruits, you know?
Mm.
And those box juices, I don't like them because they are not nutritious.
Mm-hmm.
They are more sugar-based.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing beats a fresh fruit or a fruit juice. So that's my little
That's your thing.
Yeah.
It's good. It's something that we can keep with us that you've left. All right, so you've been talking about what happens here. Let's switch over to where you live in the U.S.
Yeah.
How do you see the society? Because, of course, you see it on television, but where you live in your little corner, are they adapting to the changes and the challenges of COVID?
Yeah, mixed bag again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but the weird thing that confuses us is, let's say New York and California. You know, they've been very strict in their lockdowns, but still their numbers are high. And then you have Canada, which is, I think, the strictest country in the world. I don't know, you know, but they're next to us, so we pay attention, and I have many, many friends and families in Canada. So I don't know why they're still locked down and their numbers are up. Then you have Florida, that never really locked down, just one time a little lockdown, and they're doing great. I mean, the rest of America are going to Florida for vacation and beaches because the temperatures are great and everything, you know. And Louisiana, an example, totally 100% open, no mask required, no gloves, no nothing, and they're doing great. So it kind of confuses me, but, you know, we always want to err on the side of caution, you know, and mask up, man, wear those gloves, and just try to keep your loved ones safe. You're not just protecting yourself, but if you have it, you can infect someone else, you know. So take those necessary precautions, and let's learn how to be healthier human beings. It would help us in terms of longevity and good health.
Yeah, and while we talk about COVID and the challenges of COVID, in fact, the challenges of a musician, in your case, being a musician and working and living for a long time, we still cannot talk about your sojourn, what's happening, and not touch a little bit on COVID. And so even with COVID, before we go to your children, which is very important to your life, some economies still on COVID have benefited, and this is financially, but they would have lost, and this is because of the lives that they would have lost.
Correct.
But there is a little, do I say, positive, even if you get some finances, but no one wants to lose people just to gain some money.
Correct.
Let's talk about that.
That's right, yeah. It is very tough, you know, it is very, very tough. And main thing again, man, is for us to take all the necessary precautions. And I always look positively at things, you know, like you said, you know, let's learn from it. You know, like me, I always consider myself a student. you know, never the teacher, never the master. I want to learn. I want to learn from the young guys. I want to learn from people who are successful, who are doing great. I want to learn from the people who are dying, you know, and that's most important. You know, why did this person die? Why did they get sick? You know, how did they recover? You know, so let's use all of this as a learning experience so we can create better lives for ourselves and our families and friends, everyone around us, you know.
Right. You're a learner, but you're also a teacher. You've got two beautiful children that are doing really great. Uh-huh. And you're a proud dad. Let's talk about, you know, what's happening with them.
Yeah, my daughter, you know, she graduated out of college now and job hunting. But, you know, my son, he takes things more seriously. My daughter is elder, right? But she liked a little more socialness, right? Okay. But she's currently looking for a job, but she's out of college. So she's like, I'm going to study hard enough and things. So now to relax,
a little bit.
Enjoy, and then get into the job market. So she's in that transition phase. Okay. My son, he's 20 years old, so he is in college, and he went to aviation high school.
Okay.
So we were like, you want to fly the plane or you want to fix the plane? Yeah. But he's a hands-on guy. So right now he's actually in West Virginia because of the lockdown. Yeah. You know, he was working at JFK in New York as a student, you know, worked with Panasonic. But now he's in West Virginia, where it was the only airport that would, you know, take them in, give them jobs and stuff like that. So, but he's doing great. He's loving the experience of being in West Virginia. And it's like maybe on a 6 hours drive, depending on the traffic, from West Virginia to New York. So we see him once per month.
Okay, which is relatively good. The fact that you're seeing him and making sure that he's healthy and all is well with your children.
Certainly. You know, family is the most important thing in this world.
Yeah.
You know, so we visit him, he visits us, we make sure he's good. And we're thankful that he also realizes the importance of family. Mm-hmm. And Mark, you know, it's when you leave home.
Yeah.
That's when you start growing. Mm-hmm. You know, because you're home, like I said, you take things for granted. You're in Guyana or in your home, you know. So in the bigger scheme of things, that's when. So it's an amazing time for him right now.
Yeah, all right. So while you are a musician at heart, Terry, you're also a humanitarian. And in whenever you come back home, and we would say to Guyanese, when you see Terry home, he's always coming with something for his people. So you always bring something for your villagers. You try to make those that are lesser fortunate happy. And you've been doing this for a while. But this comes off of the family tree. This is what you started seeing your parents doing. Yeah. Let's talk about how they've handed it down to you and how you're carrying on with this legacy.
Well, you would identify with it coming from Kanji. My mom is from Kanji as well. But yeah, growing up as a little kid, it amazed me that we barely had anything. We're struggling. My dad was a teacher, but a cane cutter made more money than a school teacher. Right, but he would supplement that by fishing, and my mom planted garden and flowers, and we could barely make ends meet, but they always found a way to give back. Right, so my Aja, he was a pundit at the temple, and it kind of started with him. You know, he would dedicate so much time teaching the children, you know, do this, do that, you know. And my dad would give free lessons at home to children who weren't doing that well. My mom would plant garden. People would come, oh, auntie, give me this, you know, for dinner or whatever. My mom would always leave water outside, whatever food she has. Kids, we lived on the inside. Most people like to walk on the roadside where, you know, it's nice and paved. But it's amazed me that, you know, kids, people, they will walk in the muddy street just to pass our home because they know my mom is always there with a smile and give them something. And if we had one aspirin in that bottle, my mom and dad would fight over this, and somebody needed it, my mom would give them right away. So, you know, we kind of learned from that about giving and teaching. And it's not just about giving money, you know. Yeah, like you, Mark, you go back, people will be so happy to see you.
Give up your time.
That's right. That's the thing. And it makes you feel so good. You know, like another thing I do is I give blood, you know, every 2 months. Little things that you can do that you don't have to be rich. And I learned that from my parents. We didn't have money, but we were still able to give. And there's so much, you know, and it's only now within the past 10, 11 years that we formed a foundation just to kind of make it official. And we come, we do the medical outreaches, Christmas parties for all the orphans. On this trip here, I come. I went to your village, Canefield, met a handicapped girl. We went to Edinburgh, where the mother, you know, died, left three kids, was killed by the husband. We tried to help them. Not a family in Mike-Coney. We tried to, you know, they needed a computer and stuff. So a lot of things that, so much. But
can,
we love doing it. We love doing it.
All right. So we're just about getting ready to wrap up, Terry. Guyanese Babu, we're doing this thing. You've got some music that you published. You've got one for Holi, which we just celebrated. You came back with Pagwa, by the way.
Yes.
Did you play any Pagwa?
I did. I played Pagwa. You know, it was small, a little subdued, you know, went to Better Hope Mandir. I even went there again last night because last night was like the end of Pagwa, technically. So we did a little puja. We didn't play Pagwa last night. Just a little puja and, you know, a little prayer, sing a last chautal for the season until next year. We also went all the way up to Parika, you know, and just visited the little temples and just to kind of, you know, I'm here and sing a little song from my CD and all of that, just to make people happy.
Right. So outside of your Pagwa creation, the songs that you've done for Holi, you've also done some other pieces, and there's a compilation of the best of Terry Gajraj. What are we hearing in the compilation?
Well, you know, people love the classics. You, me, we all love. So people love hearing the Mami Bele Roti Daddy Chunky Dal, all the Lilawati, the Guyana Babu, you know. So we compiled the songs that people really loved from the older ones, to, and I added a couple of the newer ones as well. And you know, Guyana Babu has to be in there. And I feel so blessed, man, that, you know, Guyana, when people think of Guyana, Guyana Babu comes to their mind. I have people like Marshall Montano. Anywhere he sings, not only in Guyana, he sees a Guyana flag, boom, he busts out a piece of Bangali Babu. Mighty Sparrow, Calypso Rose, you know. And I have a song coming out with the Mighty Sparrow as well.
Nice.
Yes, yes, I did one with Calypso Rose, so I can't wait to share it with you guys.
That's terrific. Terry, you've been traveling quite a bit. You've been living outside for quite a while. Your legacy is one that is really strong. Do you plan to come back home and probably in your retiring years to spend more time here?
I would love to. I'd really love to. You know, I would really love to come here, serve the people, whether in government capacity or any other kind of capacity. No one has approached me for anything, but I'll say a yes right away, you know, to come back and serve the people and just kind of live in Guyana. And, you know, hopefully I can teach, you know, a nice background. And there are a lot of things that need to be done in terms of our culture and music in Guyana. And being outside looking in, and we see what other countries do. I know Guyana can make a really huge mark on the international scene to showcase, promote, and highlight our culture.
Okay, the final question to you, Terry, would be, for someone who has been listening to your music for a while and not too sure what is Terry's signature, what would you want your lasting legacy in their mind be?
Oh my goodness, you know, it would be that appreciation for whom you are, from your culture, your country. Culture embodies all of that, you know. So I always love promoting my country and where I'm from and who we are. Because if we are not proud of ourselves, you know, we'll be like a wolf in sheep's clothing, you know. You'll adopt somebody else's culture, somebody else's everything, you know. When ours is so great and so loved around the world, there is no country I've gone to that people don't I went to India and I studied so hard to learn Hindi and and you sing Hindi songs and thing, right? They wanted to hear Guyanese songs. And every country, every show I've done, them no one hear me sing American song or some. They want to hear what is a Guyanese song. What do you say in Guyanese? What do you do in Guyanese? What do you eat? So people want it from us. We just have to package it nicely and share it with the world.
Right, and this is my very last question. So final just love. And the question, the last question goes back to our topic. What would your advice be to a musician in this challenging time? Terry Gajraj has survived it, and you will continue. In fact, you don't look a day older than you are, but I'm not gonna give your age away at all. But what would your advice be to a musician in this challenging COVID time?
You know, my advice would always be one word, discipline. if you have discipline, you can survive anything. Because with discipline comes the fact that you know you have to get an education. It doesn't matter how talented you are. If you're not educated, you will lose all that money. Things will go haywire. And I've seen it over the years. I've seen so many young musicians come and go. And with discipline, it will tell you, talent, yes, but most important is that discipline, attitude, not having an ego, learn to be humble. Yeah. People, you will succeed in this world so much more than any talent could give you. You can have the greatest talent in education, but if you don't have that humility in you, you will not go anywhere. Eventually, you will fall.
Well said, my countryman, son of the soil, from the ancient county. Great having you on board. Welcome home. I know you're going to come back next, and probably we're going to have probably another discussion, but it's really terrific to have you here and continue to fly the Guyanese flag as you have been doing.
Thank you so much.
Congrats, Terry. Congrats, congrats, congrats. We've been talking with Terry Gajraj, son of the soil, Guyanese Babu, touching down just for a little bit as he continues to carry the country's flag around. It was my pleasure having you on Close Up. Do take care and thank you.
Thank you.
And to all our followers on this is NCN and on the Voice of Ghana. Thank you very much for being a part of the conversation. Do take care and goodbye.